see glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies, with angelic hosts proclaim Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Christ fly high, seven adore, Christ the everlasting Lord. Sing this to us. Glory to the King. Glory to the King. Yeah. Glory to the King. Glory to the King. Yeah. Glory to the King. Glory to the King. Yeah. Glory to the King. Glory to the King, yeah, yeah. Amen. Yeah.
Strong,
he shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne. Christ alone, Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong, in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He's Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone. Father, we come to you. We thank you. We have this time just to sing these songs to you, to worship you. Father, for sending your Son to be here among us. Father, for him living out his life as the perfect example for us to follow after. Would you speak to us today, Father? We love you and we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
You know, they never actually explained why Rudolph has a red nose.
Yeah, that's a good point.
I know.
Why did you have to ruin it?
No, I'm not ruining anything.
Come on.
Good right, choice, yes. Good choice. Good
Less
song.
Questions.
Good song. But
jingle bell, jingle bell, jingle bell, rock.
Sing it, Daniel.
Jingle bells swing and jingle bells ring. Snowing and blowing, yeah, bushels of fun. Now the jingle hop has begun.
I got one. I got one.
What?
Jingle I got
come
one.
On, come on.
Best Christmas song ever.
Really?
Yes. 100%. This is so good. Come on, guys.
The mood is right. The spirit's up. We're here tonight. And that's enough. We're simply having a wonderful
give me,
Christmas
give me that.
Time.
Hey, come on. I got a better
dude.
One.
It's not fun, is it?
Is this Christmas time?
Yeah, how about no?
I'm gonna say no.
Let's cut that. Anything but that.
I found something. You like the 80s, right?
Last Christmas.
This is not better. No!
Come on!
Not better.
I'll have a blue Christmas.
I like the classics.
Without you.
But come on.
This is classic.
You're
this is
no
the
better.
Best. Hey. Fine.
Got it. Got it.
What is this song? Wait, I know this song.
Santa baby.
No. Just stop. Give one more shot. One more
right,
shot.
Fine. Last chance, Tom. Make it good. Alright. You redeemed yourself. Good choice, Tom.
I like this song. This is good.
Alright, you sing it, Tom. We'll back you up.
Christmas.
Oh my, good morning, New Life Chantilly. Morning, New Life Chantilly. Hey, I'm Mike Fuster, Chantilly Campus Pastor. I know you were a little stunned probably by that, as I was for sure, man. A little too early for Tom Pounder in that voice, isn't it? Hey, so welcome everyone. So glad to be here with y'all this morning. And man, so glad to see you guys at 8 a.m. on a chilly Sunday morning. And hey, special welcome to you all that are viewing via our live stream. Always glad when you guys decide to join us as well. As always, hey, would you say good morning to your chat host? Again, they love to interact with you throughout the service this morning. And they'd also love to know where you're watching from as well and who's watching with you today too. Those of you that came in live today, hope you grabbed one of these, right? It's always full of good stuff, especially our calendar of upcoming events. And this is full of good stuff this morning. There is so much going on here during this Christmas season. One thing I want to bring your attention off of this is at the very top, you may have noticed we have our beautiful, large, live Christmas tree in the lobby. We're encouraging everyone to contribute to that tree. Bring in an ornament, maybe something that's specific for your family. We are asking you to contribute it so we can keep it and hold on to that for the upcoming years and just keep adding to that tree. So consider doing that over the next few weeks as well. Also in here is our Get Connected card. Again, for you new folks, special welcome. If this is your first time with us, glad that you're here this morning. But this is a good place for you to connect with us for the first time. Name and email is a great way to do that. If you give us your address, I'll actually send you something in the mail, kind of get you started here at New Life. At the very bottom is our prayer request area. It's in the middle, actually. I forgot we moved it there, give you a little bit more space. But this is important, very important. We really value prayer and believe that God hears and wants to hear our prayers. If you'll fill that out, we'd love to be praying with you, for you, or maybe someone that you know that needs prayer right now. We have a prayer team. They meet during second service, and they'd love to be hearing and praying with you. Also, at the end of services, we always have folks in the back that love to pray with you before you leave this place today. And then there's a section, if you've been here for a while, yet you haven't found that place to plug in, maybe in a small group or to serve here and be a part of what happens on Sunday mornings, someone would love to connect with you and help you find that place to connect here at New Life. Well, we're in that Christmas season, and if you're new with us, you may not know this, but we are one church, and we love to say we meet in three locations, right? You're here. We have our online campus, but we also have a campus just west of here in Linton Hall, and we have our Linton Hall campus pastor, Stan Rodas, going to share his message with us today on Christmas.
Right. Good morning, Chantilly. Man, that's a wonderful response. Coffee must have kicked in bright and early. 8 a.m. for you all. That's fantastic. Hey, we're just going to be walking through some Christmassy message stuff today. And as I was thinking about kind of how to walk through our morning together, one of the things that just kind of came to mind was this idea of anticipation and waiting for something great that may be coming, something you're ready for, something great. You know that feeling you get in the pit of your stomach when you're anticipating something that is incoming, something that is good, that feeling you get right here? It's like that kid in the commercial, the Disney World commercial, and the kid's like, I'm too excited to sleep. You know, that feeling you get, I can't sleep. Maybe for you, it's, you know, a family member who is in the military, was deployed for X amount of months or years or whatever the number may be, and they are finally coming home, and that anticipation and the waiting, it all begins to build, and the closer and closer you get, the more anxious and excited. I'm too excited to sleep. They're coming home. Like, you know that feeling you get in the pit of your stomach? Maybe it's a family reunion. Maybe you're big on family reunions and you've not seen your family in years, but there's one coming and everybody's getting together and you're coming together from all corners of the country. It's going to be great. It's going to be this awesome celebration. And as the time gets closer, I'm too excited to sleep. Just this anticipation begins to build inside of you. You know, waiting in anticipation is kind of a shared human experience. I think we've all been there in one way or another, having to wait for something great that's coming. I've had many moments like that myself, where I'm waiting for the arrival of something and the anticipation builds and the excitement grows. One of the ones for me was my wedding day. So whenever you decide to get married, you ask a question, "Will you marry me?" And the hope is that the person, your soon-to-be spouse, will respond with a yes. And so she said yes, fortunately, and we set a date. And that's all we really knew. There was a date coming out in the future when we were going to be married. And then as time passed and details and nuances and what are the flowers going to look like and what's the color and the theme going to be and all those things that I really didn't care all that much about, but the details begin to come together and months become weeks, become days, become hours. And before you know it, I'm in a tuxedo at the front of a church waiting for the doors in the back to open, and the excitement, the anticipation just builds and builds and builds. Our culture doesn't like this feeling as much, maybe, as it used to. We seem to be cutting down on wait times more and more all the time. Now you can order something on Amazon that used to take you 10 days to get. Now you can get it Amazon Prime either overnight or in 2 days. And if you go with 2-day shipping, after day one, you're still sitting at the door going, "Is it here yet? Maybe they were ahead of schedule. Maybe the Amazon order's here. Oh, did Amazon get here yet?" You know, and you're like, we're like addicts waiting on Amazon to show up, right? If you go through the drive-thru at Chick-fil-A, what's the worst you're going to have experienced at Chick-fil-A? What, a 3-minute wait for the perfect order with great service? No, not good enough. Now we need to, I should probably order ahead on my mobile device and place a mobile order so that when I get there, like, we don't really like the wait anymore. We can't be bothered to wait in line for 5 minutes. But when you finally get that thing, man, it is all worth it. When you finally see that family member, when you get to go on that trip, when you see your bride walking down the aisle, when you hold your child for the first time, all of the waiting and the anticipation is all worth it. Well, I want to tell you a story about anticipation. Today, anticipation, a moment that's so great, it actually took thousands of years to develop the story, and it's one of the most climactic moments in all of human history, and we celebrate it with the word Advent, and Advent is just a word that means arrival. And so here's what I want us to do today. I just want us to join the people of God in the Old Testament as they waited, as the anticipation grew for everything around them to change, to join them as God reveals piece at a time, detail at a time, moment at a time, as God begins to put the story together, and the anticipation over those years builds and builds and builds toward the day that God will restore all things to himself. If you're here today and you're a believer, I just hope today encourages you. If you're here today and you're not a believer, I hope today encourages you. But I hope it encourages you to continue asking your questions about God and faith. So we're just going to get started way back in the beginning, and we've got thousands of years of history to cover in about a 35-minute window. And so don't expect this to be a really slow process. We're going to move very quickly through history, but we just want to start with what the basics are of what Christians believe. At the very beginning, we believe that God created all that we can see and all that we cannot see, and it was good. God is good and created everything good. But as the opening scene of the Bible plays out, there's another force that enters into the scene. Something disrupts the good that God has created. And in that scene, sin and evil and death interrupt and disrupt what God is doing in the world. And in that moment, the universe, the entire universe, everything we know and see and experience is fractured. When sin enters the world and into us as human beings, all that is meant for good suddenly changes. All those things that were meant for your good now suddenly become things that can be meant for your detriment. They are things that can now become idols. Now we don't worship the creator, we worship the created. Everything has changed in the moment that sin entered into the world. Now, whether you are here today and you hold to that belief and that is your worldview, whether you're there or not, I think we can all agree that something in the world seems off. That the world is a messed up place, regardless of even where you kind of find yourself saying that the foundation of that is, we can all agree on the fact that something is off, that the world is messed up, that it is a broken place. Wars and racial tensions, suicide bombings, church shootings, tension in your relationships, hopelessness, no sense of purpose. Something is off. And we ask the question, is this all there is? Is this really all that it was meant to be? Is this really all there is to this human experience? Romans chapter 8 and verse 22 simply tells us that all of creation groans under death and decay. We know that the entire universe is fractured as a result of sin, and all of God's creation groans. And that passage goes on to say, like a woman in labor, it is a painful process. Life is painful. The earth is painful. Things are not the way they were meant to be. And so we wait for something different because we were designed for something different. Why does it hurt so bad when you lose someone you love? Because you weren't designed for loss. You weren't designed for death. And so when death entered into the scene, it fractured that moment. And now when you lose someone, there is pain. You weren't designed for the pain. You weren't designed for that loss and that hurt. And so we wait anxiously for God to intervene and to restore the universe and humanity back to its original design and intent. And this anticipation, this waiting, began immediately after the fall. Immediately after Adam and Eve fell short in the temptation and Satan tempts them to disobey God by eating of a tree he said not to eat from. As soon as they do that and the universe breaks, God intervenes into the story. He intervenes to Adam and Eve and the serpent in Genesis chapter 3. And this is where he begins putting the wheels in motion. The Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and above all beasts of the field. On your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head, you shall bruise his heel. Now this is the reason why no good God-fearing Christian should like snakes, because they are the personification of evil since the beginning of time. And even God is like, nope, sorry, not with snakes. And so if you believe in God and love all things that are good and holy, you can't like snakes. Now, God does not reveal in this moment the entire picture. He doesn't give them every single detail. He just gives them a glimpse of what is going to happen. Satan, the instigator of evil and sin, the deceiver, the one who tempted Adam and Eve, the source of the fractured universe, will have his head crushed by someone. The someone is a son. We get a glimpse into the plan that the person that this plan that God is developing goes through a son, a he who will be born of a woman. All we know at this point in the story now is it's a son born of a woman who is going to crush Satan's head. He will defeat sin and death. That's all we know. It's just a son. And after this revelation, and God gives this piece of detail, he moves forward, putting this plan, continuing this plan in action. And he does it by beginning a family, and he does that through a man named Abram in Genesis chapter 12. And he's going to reveal some more of the details of this waiting process to this man, Abram, this patriarch of a family that will become something great. Abram is called by God somewhere around the year 2200 BC, and in that time, we're given this other detail that God shares with him. Genesis chapter 12, starting in verse 2. I will make of you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, so you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. The first detail that we see as God begins this plan is the plan is a son, is a person, the son born of a woman. And then this next little piece of information we get is it will be from the line of Abram. And we know that the line of Abram feeds into the Jewish people, the Israelite people. And so what we know now is that the son born of a woman will be a Jew. That's what we know. That's what we know of the story of redemption so far. A son born of a woman who will be a Jew is coming. We don't know much more than that. And all in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Now, sometime around 15 years later from this promise, God comes back to Abram. Abram has made some mistakes along the way. He's had this other son with a woman who's not his wife. There's been some other mistakes made. So 15 years from here, God comes back and shares more details. Genesis chapter 17. No longer shall your name be called Abram, but your name shall be Abraham, for I have made you the father of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make you into nations. Kings shall come from you. And I will establish my covenant between me and you and your offspring after you throughout their generations for an everlasting covenant, to be God to you and to your offspring after you. Literally in this moment, because of the relationship that Abram has with God and what God is doing through him, he literally shifts his identity and changes his name from Abram to Abraham. And then we get another peek, another detail at this plan, at the son. The anticipation builds just a little bit more. He will be a son born of a woman. He will be a Jew, and he will come through the line of kings. Abraham doesn't even know what that means. There are no kings. There's not even an Israelite people yet. It's just Abraham and his family. He can't see what this really means, but there are kings that are coming, and this son to be born is going to come through them. So whatever is happening, God is going to do it through a son who will be a Jew, and he will be a king. And that's what we know, and the anticipation builds that God is still working, God is faithful, God is up to something. And so here we are actually at this point, by the time we get to Abram, we're actually thousands of years into history, thousands of years into the story. We know something isn't right. We know the universe is fractured, we are broken, and the things with God have not been the same. And all we know is a son who is a Jew, who will be a Jew, and that king is on the way. Have you ever been in a season of waiting, where you're just waiting on something? You've got this wait thing going on. You begin to ask the question, what's next? God, what are you doing in this moment? God, what do you have for me next? God, can you skip the puzzle pieces? Can you skip the timeline? God, if you would, just tell me what you want me to do now. If you could just audibly kind of show up and just tell me what's next and give me the answers. God, I don't want to wait. I just give me the answers. You know, those seasons of waiting for us can be really, really difficult. And if you're in one of those seasons of waiting, I just want to encourage you today to just be faithful one step at a time, following God as he develops the picture for you in his time, just one step at a time. And then by the end of the book of Genesis, years of history have gone by. In Genesis chapter 49, we're finally given another detail, another piece of information that builds the anticipation toward this son who is to come. And it is given to a man by the name of Judah in Genesis chapter 49. Now, this is an interesting story. It's actually a very awkward family story in this moment. This is like one of those awkward family scenes. You might see something like this on a sitcom. I mean, this is just a really awkward moment in Genesis chapter 49. So in the culture of the day in Genesis chapter 49, the way it worked was that the firstborn son would receive the best of the inheritance. He got the best blessings, the most money, the most land, the most sheep, the prettiest women. Like, the firstborn son got it all. They were, that's just how it went. They got everything. And then we get to this story, and we run across a man by the name of Jacob, who is Abraham's grandson, and we run into this really awkward family conversation where we're just kind of peering in, and Jacob is having a conversation with his 12 sons. And it doesn't start super well. He is talking to the oldest one, whose name is Reuben, and he tells Reuben, hey, listen, you're not getting anything. You're unstable like water. Oh, wow. Thanks, Dad. Love you too. Unstable like water, not a very stable surface, right? He gets to sons 2 and 3 and he says, you guys aren't getting anything either. You're too violent. And in fact, I don't even want to be associated with either one of you. Oh, wow. Great. Thanks, Dad. Love you too. Like, this is like ultimate in awkward moments as the dad just goes through ripping the kids apart one by one. And then we get to son number 4, a son named Judah. In Genesis chapter 49, starting in verse 8, Judah, your brothers shall praise you. This is really weird because that's not how it's supposed to work. Everybody's supposed to praise the oldest. And in this moment, it's not happening. It's happening to the fourth son. Your hand shall be on the neck of your enemies. Your father's sons shall bow down before you. Judah is a lion's cub. From the prey, my son, you have gone up. He stooped down, he crouched as a lion and as a lioness. Who dares rouse him? The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet, until tribute comes to him. And to him shall be the obedience of the peoples. Judah, great things are in store for you, my son. Your brothers are going to bow before you. You have grown up so much. You are powerful and you are strong. Your enemies are going to be beneath you. Great things are coming your way. What great things? The scepter will not depart from Judah. Now, at the very least, this is a prophecy about a coming king by the name of King David, who we're going to talk about next. He won't be on the scene for hundreds of years, but the prophecy here ultimately that's running through the line of Judah speaks to the son. Speaks to that son who will be born of a woman who is coming someday, that God is working the plan to restore all things back to himself through this son. And whenever you get to the last book in the Bible, you're going to come across a chapter there, Revelation chapter 5. And in Revelation chapter 5, that son will be called the Lion of the Tribe of Judah, and every knee will bow, and every tongue will confess that he is Lord to the glory of God the Father, and to him shall be the obedience of all peoples. You see, God building the anticipation for someone to come. I mean, it really gets exciting as you think about that. God is up to something. He is faithful. He is working. Something is happening. Someone is coming, and it is going to be a great day. And the people of Israel just look forward to this and look forward to this for thousands of years. God, what are you doing? What are you up to? Why do we have to wait hundreds of years more? Why the wait? All this pain and suffering, all this stuff is going on. We all know it. We all see it. We can all feel it. Something's not right. Can't you speed this up a bit? I mean, I want my 2-day Amazon order. Let's go. I mobile ordered this salvation a long time ago. Like, let's get moving. I mean, we're working on 4G, LTE, Google fiber speeds, and God's up in heaven like, you know, rock and dial up. Like, God, get with the times. What's the wait for? Have you ever noticed that God doesn't really work on Northern Virginia time like the rest of us? It's like, come on, man, speed this thing up. And God just like, no, we're going to wait. Years, generations go by, and finally King David arrives. And along with him, another detail. King David in 2 Samuel chapter 7. What you need to know about David, he's the king of the nation of Israel. He is a man after God's own heart. He is the king by which all kings of Israel will be measured. Every king after him, they will say, yeah, but was he like David? Was he as good as David? He is the measuring stick for kings in Israel. And this is what God tells him in 2 Samuel chapter 7, starting in verse 11. When your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name. I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. Now, that's a good spot to pause and just reflect. What do we know so far? What do we have so far in the story as the anticipation builds? As we anxiously await the advent, the arrival, this is what we know. A son, he'll be a Jew from the lineage of kings, from the tribe of Judah, and his kingdom will never end. Here's what we don't know. How he's going to destroy sin and death, and how it's a blessing to all the nations of the earth. And so you continue to peer into the life of David, and you continue to read and follow and some of the things that he wrote, and you get more of the picture. Psalm chapter 22, David writes of a suffering Messiah. The word Messiah means the anointed, the chosen one. So this still refers to that son who is coming is the Messiah, the one who is chosen, and he will suffer. Psalm chapter 110, David writes of this son being installed at God's right hand, at the throne of God, at the right hand of God himself. Do you see what this is for the people living in the Old Testament? Do you see what this storyline is for them? Do you see? It's the substance of the gospel. We have the benefit of hindsight looking back and being able to point all of these things to a person and say, this is the story, this is the gospel, this is who it's about. Do you know what they had? Details, pictures, a moment in time, a prophecy here and there. And all of those begin to build and to create a story and to create a picture of the one who is to come, who will restore all things. This is the gospel. This is what they lived for. This is what they knew. We are the ones who are going to bring a Savior. That's all we know. This is the gospel. This is the heart of the gospel for the people in the Old Testament who are living for God. But then 41 years after King David's death, something tragic happens that threatens the entire plan. A king by the name of King Rehoboam, the king of Israel, he's David's grandson, is king of Israel, and he splits the kingdom into two, puts everything in jeopardy. This divided Israel ultimately leads them into captivities, into slaveries, to enemy nations. Everything has changed. They're not united. And from captivity and from slavery into the prophets of the Old Testament, you begin to read and to hear the people with a very similar message as they cry out to God. God, what are you doing? What about your promise? What about David's throne? What about the kingdom that will last forever? God, what about this kingdom you promised? You said it was coming. You said it was coming through us. And now here we are. And we're slaves. We're not even united. The temple is torn down. God, we have nothing. I thought you promised, God, that all of this was going to happen. It was the anticipation of a coming son. This hope of this kind of gospel story in the Old Testament that kept them going. Even through slavery, it was the thing that got them through. It was the thing that drove them further and drove them forward. God, what are you up to? I mean, they believed so strongly that this son, this anointed one was coming through Jewish heritage, and that if the Jewish nation was wiped out and they couldn't get this thing together, they knew that there could be no Messiah. Now, they still don't know what that ultimately means. They don't ultimately know what it looks like or what God's building it into. They just know they are living for the hope of someone who is coming to restore all things, the hope of a Messiah coming to set things right. And if their nation ceases to exist, so does the Messiah. Haven't you ever been there? God, I thought this relationship was the one. I thought this was the person you wanted me to be with, God, and then they did this. God, I don't understand, God. I thought you were going to have me with this person forever. God, I thought that you had me on this career path for a reason. God, I don't understand what you're doing in this moment and why I've lost this career. God, I don't understand what you're doing in my family. God, I don't understand why you would take that person away from us at such a young age. It doesn't make any sense, God. That's not how this was supposed to be. How do you expect, God, for us to continue on? God, you promised that you were a good father and the giver of good gifts, and yet somebody has died. I don't get it, God. It doesn't make sense. What are you doing? You said, God, what's going on? Right? you've been there, right? God, I thought you were up to this. This is where the prophets come in so beautifully. The men who spoke and wrote on behalf of God. And this is where the last couple hundred years of the Old Testament come into play. And so if you're here today and you're going through a season like this, this is why you must ground yourself in the Word of God. Because as the prophets speak, they also write. And they ground you in a bunch of great things about God and ultimately his faithfulness. But God, through the prophets, shows the people of Israel that he hasn't forgotten his promise, that good news is still on the way, that the anticipation for a Messiah ultimately through the prophets reaches a boiling point. I mean, it just begins to just explode with anticipation and excitement. Now, remember, as you begin the anticipation process or you're looking forward to a day, initially you don't have a lot of details. It's the wedding day that's coming, but initially it's just a date that is set. And then pretty soon you have a little bit more of the picture. You have a location, and then you have a theme, and then you have colors, and then you have the dress design, and then you have this, and it just begins to zoom in. God is zooming in. God is zooming in on the big picture from the very beginning, and through the prophets, God is putting that bad boy under a microscope, and it is zooming in on the details of who this person will be. And he does a lot of it through the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 7, starting in verse 14, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel." There are two beautiful pieces of detail here. Beautiful pieces of information. One, the son born of a woman is not going to be born of just any woman. It's going to be a virgin. Now, we all know that's not how that works. Okay? So the only way this is happening is if God's involved in it. There's no other answer for this. God is either involved in this or he is not, and God is involved in this. God is all in on the story. But not only will he be born of a virgin, he'll call his name Emmanuel. Emmanuel means God with us. I mean, this isn't just any son. This is God in the flesh. This is God giving a part of himself to walk this earth with us. And as Isaiah writes, the picture just zooms in more and more and more. Isaiah chapter 9, the Messiah will honor Galilee. It will be his place of ministry. Isaiah chapter 11, the Messiah will be empowered through the Holy Spirit. I remember a baptism story and the Holy Spirit descending on someone somewhere out there. Isaiah chapter 49, the Messiah will bring salvation to the Gentiles. You remember back in Genesis chapter 12, when God said what to Abraham? "You will be a blessing to all nations. The Son will save and bring salvation even to the Gentiles." Now the picture is this isn't even about us anymore. This isn't even about the Jews. This is for the planet. Isaiah chapter 53, "He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds, we are healed." The Messiah will bear our sins in suffering in some way. Remember, sin is what started this whole mess. Sin is what fractured the universe. It's what destroyed the relationship between man and God. It is what brought death to the planet. And now we see that the Messiah will bear our sins. He will be crushed and he will be wounded for our sins. But through his being wounded for our sins, he will ultimately destroy death and sin itself. This is why we ground ourselves in the Word of God, because God is faithful. God is faithful to us. Even when all seems lost, even when everything seems to be falling apart, God is still at work. And even in the midst of slavery and captivity, God is still working. The details are still coming together. The plan, the picture is zooming in more and more. God is faithful. And now we have a clear picture of who it is. We know how he's going to do it. We know why it's a big deal for all people. It's coming together now, thousands of years from the beginning in advance, and now at a point hundreds of years before it happens, there is coming a son who will be a Jew. He will be born in the line of kings. He will be the Lion of the tribe of Judah. His kingdom will have no end. He will be born of a virgin. He will call Galilee home. He will be Emmanuel, God with us, God in the flesh, and he will bear our sins sins and suffering, and all things eventually will be restored to God through the Son. What's God saying? What's God saying to his people through these prophets, through these words? He's saying, oh Israel, keep your head up. God is fighting for you. I am fighting for you. God is coming through for you. God is fulfilling his promises made to Adam and to Eve and to the serpent and to Abram and Abraham and to David and to the he is fulfilling his promises. What would he say to you if he were here today? Oh, exhausted single mom, be encouraged. Weary parents, stand firm. You who have been burned by relationships, stay focused on God. Oh, hurting widow, widower, keep your head up. Struggling spouse, stay faithful. Oh, addicted person, there is freedom. Oh, skeptic of faith, bring your questions, bring your doubts, because unto us a child is born, who will crush sin and death and will make all things new. And his name is Jesus. See, the anticipation, the waiting, thousands of years of waiting come down to a single moment in history when a child will be born in a stable and lie in a manger. And man, with a buildup like that of thousands of years of history, you would expect quite the spectacle when that son arrives. But God is full of surprises, and if you want to hear the arrival story, you're going to have to come back next week. You know, the reality for us really is that the anticipation becomes a question of next steps and what's next for each of us and what God is calling each of us to do. And then there's a whole laundry list of things that we could say here, but I want to focus you in on one. I want to focus you in on one next step that I want every single person to leave here and follow and pursue and go after. This is the thing for the next couple of weeks that I want you to pursue. I want hopeful anticipation to build inside of you, to build inside of your heart and your soul. Not the anticipation for more presents under the tree, not the anticipation that the family thing is going to be the best, not the anticipation that travel is going to be whatever, not the anticipation that the sugar cookies are going to be better than last year's sugar cookies, not the anticipation that the ham or the turkey or whatever it is that your tradition is, not the anticipation that this Christmas will be the best one yet, but that this Advent season will be the one that is the best one yet, where my heart and my soul no longer clamor for the consumeristic things of the Christmas holiday, but that my soul is so thirsty for the things of God as I await the arrival of the one, of the chosen one, the Son, the Messiah, who God has planned for since the beginning. May our hearts and our souls be burdened as we wait in anticipation the celebration of the arrival of the Son. Let's pray together. Father God, you do things in waiting sometimes that drive us crazy in our fast-paced culture. But God, you are at work and you are faithful and you are coming through for your people and you have come through for your people. God, you're faithful all the time. God, even when we are faithless and when we fall short, God, you remain faithful. And God, you have prepared a time. You've seen all of this happen. You've seen history. You knew the story before it began. And God, you have prepared your Son for us, for this, for all of humanity. God, may we in this moment, may this not be a season of waiting for the best Christmas yet. Help us maybe to even forget the word Christmas for a time. And to think about Advent, think about arrival, think about the thousands of years of gospel hope the Old Testament people waited for, the faith of people who couldn't see what was to come but continued to push forward toward what you were up to and what you were doing. God, allow us to see that and to build in this anticipation that this season is about arrival. It's about the arrival of a son who will restore all things to himself and back to you, God the Father. We love you. It's in your son's name that we pray. Amen. Each week at New Life, we kind of close this part of our service with a time of communion. Communion's a time where we focus to the cross of Christ, that place of suffering prophesied in Psalm 22 and in Isaiah 53. We focus on the cross and what Jesus did for us in that moment and what it means and how through his death on the cross, ultimately his resurrection, that Jesus is destroying, he's crushing the effects of sin and death and will one day restore all things to himself. But on the cross, Jesus said something very interesting. He said, "It is finished." That it is finished. My work on earth is done. All of the anticipation, thousands of years, generations looked forward to the arrival. And he came, he did his work, he lived out his purpose. It was fulfilled, it was finished, it was complete. But before he left earth, he left us with a meal to remember him, to remember his life and his ministry. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 26 said, when you take this meal, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. That gives us pause because I thought he already came. See, the Advent is the celebration of the arrival. He already came, so why continue the meal to remember? Because it's already done. See, Christmas, we celebrate the first arrival when Jesus came as a baby, when he came as Messiah. But at communion, we proclaim him until his second arrival, until his second advent, when he comes back again and when every knee bows and every tongue confesses that he is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And communion is the time that unifies us as we all say together, we await your arrival, Lord Jesus. We proclaim your death until you come back. And so today it's not just about what happened as a son, but it is waiting the second arrival of King Jesus. Let's share together now in communion.
God. Lord, it's this time of communion that we remember the sacrifice that you did make for us. Love, God, that is beyond comprehension. God, I pray right now that you would speak into our hearts, that we would experience that love in a new and a fresh way, and that it would change us anew today, God. God, we'll never be able to thank you enough for that, but as we leave this place, we would love differently because you first loved us. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, man, what a great start to our Christmas season. I look forward to the next few weeks leading up to Christmas Eve, as I pray you all do too. We're going to move into the time of the giving and receiving of tithes and offerings. And I first like to speak always to the new folks. If you're here for the very first time, again, we're so glad that you decided to join us this morning. Pray that you will throughout the rest of the Christmas season. But please, during this time of the giving, receiving, tithes, and offerings, if you came prepared, we do say thank you for that. But if you're still checking us out, right, you're wondering who New Life is, don't feel that you need to give out of any sense of obligation or just, well, I'm at church, that's just what you do. But it just spend some time. I always tell folks, pray about what it means for your family to give sacrificially. Once you decide to say, you know what, this is my church. You know, when people say, well, where do you go to church? Well, New Life, that's my church. That's that time when you make a conscious decision to say, that's the place we're going to give to. Those of us that call this place home, right, we've made that decision, and we want to support the efforts of what God has called us to do in this small little outpost that he's given us to serve in this community. So, guys and gals, come on down. While they're taking up the offering, take a look at this short video.
Hi, my name is Leo, and I've been coming to New Life since the 90s. One thing that I've noticed about New Life is that it just keeps growing. I'm so impressed with all the stuff that we're able to do now here at the end zone, at church plants all over the place. It's amazing just the impact that we're making. And one thing that if you've been coming here any amount of time, you've heard everybody say, look, giving's important. And as a cynic, I'm gonna let you know, I know what runs through a lot of people's minds. Oh, great, the church is asking for more money. But when you're able to see what we give and what we do, here at New Life as the church, how we support the mission and all the missions that are going on, it's amazing. I believe in this mission, and I really hope that you will see all the good that it does. And I hope that you also consider year in giving. This is a place where the money's gonna go a lot farther than you could ever imagine. So trust God with your year in gift and see what he can do. And I think you're gonna be amazed, as I've been all these years watching New Life grow. Watching New Life grow.
That's awesome. He's been here since the 90s, and I haven't been here since the 90s, but ever since I've been here, I've known Leo. And if you were here during the financial panel that we had, he and his wife were up here. And I love what he said about see what God can do with your end-of-year giving, and it has been amazing. I wish I could list some of the amazing things that have happened just through end-of-year giving. So we know a lot of you are considering what you're going to do with your end-of-year giving in different places that you're considering. And we just ask you to pray about what that means to give to New Life and the efforts that we're doing through church planting and here locally. So I have a couple of announcements for this end-of-year as well. And first is that, oh, sorry, I've got several, so I have them on my phone, so I just don't forget you guys. But the biggest I wanted to remind you guys is the next few weeks. Christmas Eve is coming, right? I mentioned that earlier. Last year we had a Christmas Eve production. As wonderful as it was, and it was absolutely amazing, this year, man, the effort these folks have been putting in, our creative department and our kids ministry has just been phenomenal. If you notice, like, the camel and some of that stuff that's out there, it's just sick, you know, how creative these people are. But we're having 5 services this year. You see the times up there, 11, 1:30, 3, 4:30, and 6. So start thinking about considering what service your family's going to attend. And then my encouragement is to figure out what service you'd like to serve at. And we have a multitude of opportunities, right? This is that time of year, Christmas Eve and Easter, when people will come back to church for the very first time. They'll come back or come for the very first time. So consider that. On top of that, my goal, 3,000 cookies. Okay, so you bakers, consider that. You non-bakers, consider buying them, right? It's going to take a lot of cookies, and that's our big thing we like to do up front, is welcome people with cookies on Christmas Eve. So that's my big one for Christmas Eve. Also, park far, sit close. I'm going to not make you all say that, but next week I'm going to ask you that question, right? It means park across the street at Long Foster. We'll have shuttles to bring you over and back, and then you have to get real cozy with each other to make room for all those new folks that will be coming in. All right, first one. Secondly, next Sunday is honestly during the season. You guys have been amazing through your generosity and through your serving. I am just blown away by what that's been. Well, next week is like one of my favorite things we do through the season. It's our last kind of big hurrah before we go into Christmas Eve. And that's our Christmas shop. It's when we bring in children through a local neighborhood and we allow them to shop for mom and dad for free. We entertain their parents with some caroling and some snacks and things like that while they shop and wrap their gifts. What we need right now are gifts, right? We need actually mom and dad gifts, right? You guys have done an amazing thing bringing in children's gifts. We're looking at gifts for under $15, mom and dad gifts. We roughly need about 300. We're asking if we can get those in by Wednesday, right? That would be fantastic so we can put those together. It's a short timeline. You can bring those throughout the week. If they come in a little bit later, we're not going to say no, right? But that's what we're looking for. There's a sheet of paper in your seats. Gives you a little bit more information about that. All right. Now, the big one that you guys are going to love, I have this little tiny white cup up here. It's full of the most amazing carrot soup I've ever had in my life. Not that I've had a lot of carrot soups, but this one is crazy good, and I got it at the New Fuel Cafe. If you notice, the past few weeks, there's been a sign up there. We relaunched the cafe, and it's now called Fuel, and it's being run by a four-star chef by the name of Ruslan, and we can thank Stan because he comes from the Linton Hall campus. And he is the guy that's now going to be managing and running that place, and he's a crazy good chef. So he's got a whole bunch of free food out there, samples for you all to try on your way out today, and you will not be disappointed. He's been feeding us, the staff here, for like the past month. He just keeps coming to the office with samples and samples, and we're all like, this is ridiculously good. So on your way out today, make sure you grab some of those. I know it's like 9-something, and you're going to get carrot soup, along with a whole bunch of other stuff like chili, mac and cheese, mint and agave fruit cup, Italian subs, Cobb salad. It's pretty good. All right, awesome. If y'all would stand, want to pray, then you go out and enjoy some of that free stuff. Father God, Lord, we thank you as always for the day, but God, for this place, and place where you're going to give us an opportunity to serve the community. And God, where so many people will come, we know, for the very first time on Christmas Eve. So I pray, God, for the next few weeks that you prepare our hearts. God, for all those folks, that we'd be ready to make this the most welcoming place on Christmas Eve. God, I pray that this week, as we leave out of this place, that you'd help us to be a bright light in our community, that people would know that we are different, and we are different because you love us. So God, we thank you for all you do, especially for Jesus. I call this in his name. Amen. Have a great week.